everyone. Good evening. Thanks for being here. Thanks, Aiden, for those remarks. We have Jeremy immediately to my left, and then...
I wore a cheat sheet, so everyone
can tell. We missed the memo on the t-shirts. So we're here to discuss the future of the EPA, and I think it's safe to say we have two experts here who have diametrically opposed viewpoints on what the future of the agency... Right, we found one thing to agree on. What the future of the agency should look like. So we'll discuss here for about 40 minutes, and then we're going to throw it out to you guys for questions, so please be thinking about that. First, a very quick recap of the latest state of play, in case you have been living under a rock or studying. President Trump said on the campaign trail that he wanted to basically eliminate most of the EPA, and his budget proposal goes a good bit of the way to do that. He proposes cutting the EPA's budget about 31% to about $5.7 billion, which, for perspective, is about how much the agency had in its budget in 1990. This 31% cut, which is the biggest of any federal agency, would result in about a 20% cut in the agency's staff, which is about 3,200 people. And the agency has about 15,000 people. So to be clear, in case you're not familiar with how presidential budgets work, presidents release budget proposals like this every year, the details of which never actually become law. It's basically a blueprint to offer Congress something to go off of. So that's important, because these cuts are significant, and it does show a big change in direction, but it doesn't mean it will become law. So with that quick background, Myron, I want to start with you. Looks like you have some thoughts about my introductory remarks, which you can always share. Myron, in case you guys don't know, he was an advisor to the Trump transition team, specifically focused on EPA, and I think it's correct to say that you are no longer advising
the
administration. Okay. I'm sure you have some emails and phone numbers, though, you might use every now and again. You've recently said that you wanted EPA to reduce its workforce to 5,000 people, down to the levels about that President Nixon had when he first created the agency in 1970, which was a comment that raised some eyebrows among people on all sides of this issue. Realizing that this budget proposal doesn't go as far as that, does it go far enough for you?
Amy, first let me thank Aidan Johnson and the Lecture Fund for arranging this event and inviting me and Jeremy and you. And for all of you for coming. I hope we have an interesting and useful conversation. I didn't say anything during the transition because I wasn't allowed to. So after Inauguration Day, I said a lot of things to you and to others. And one of the things I said was that I thought it was a good aspirational goal to achieve President Trump's campaign promise to either abolish the EPA or leave a little bit, to aim to reduce the workforce between a half and two-thirds in his first term. And I said that for the first year, perhaps a 10% budget cut would be achievable. So the budget request in Congress is 31%, so now I look like the moderate. I wasn't ambitious enough in my thinking. But as you said, Congress appropriates the money. The president suggests or requests that Congress appropriates it. Clearly, every one of these line items is going to be a debate in the Appropriations Committee in the House and the Senate. I don't think anyone thinks they're going to get a 31% cut. But on the other hand, the idea that we're going to increase defense spending by $54 billion, and that requires a domestic cut of $54 billion, means that the president and the administration, and particularly Mick Mulvaney and OMB, are going to be putting significant pressure on the Congress to cut spending somewhere. So I think EPA is in line for some cuts, whether it's 31%, I think, people laugh at that, but I think that's an aspirational goal.
Jeremy, I imagine you don't like anything about President Trump's budget proposal, but what worries you the most about it?
Well, I like that he has to get it through Congress.
You're saying that with a Republican control?
With a Republican-controlled Congress, because this proposal is so extreme that I don't believe that it'll get through. I think Myron and I agree on that. But let's be clear about a couple things. This has nothing to do with balancing the budget. you know, and I know it. This is about an agenda aimed at dismantling the Enviornmental Protection Agency. The entire budget for EPA accounts for 0.2% of federal spending. It's not going to make a dent in, you know, funding increase in defense or during the campaign. Then candidate Trump said he was going to cut EPA as his prime example of how he's going to balance the budget, which is somehow lost in this equation. So that's not what this is about. This is about, you mentioned the budget's a blueprint. You know, and that got me thinking. I mean, this most budgets are a blueprint they build. This is a demolition plan. And as you said, Myron, you know, anybody at the first year of an administration thinks about it stepwise. You come in, you take the first cuts, knowing you have 4 years to come back again and again. And they went right for the throat day one. And the reasons for that are that they have an agenda. This administration has an agenda that's extreme, that's out of touch, I think, with the public, which is what our own rallying cry and defense will be ultimately. But that agenda is to fundamentally weaken the agency. It has nothing to do with budget saving. It's about getting the federal government out of the business of protecting public health and protecting the environment. And that's dangerous, and that's a great concern to us.
And here's a question for you guys out in the audience. How much are you, how many of you are monitoring the budget debate here in Washington? Is this something you guys pay attention to? Oh, good.
Okay.
Just checking. because it can be kind of a dry topic. But again, you know, these numbers, beyond the numbers, they do represent the direction that the new Trump administration wants to go. I've covered many budgets in the past, and many of them under President Obama, especially during his waning years, I didn't really pay attention to because we knew what he was going to do and we knew what Congress was going to do. But this is a more important document because it was the first sign that we saw of which direction Trump wanted to go and if he was indeed going to follow through on what he said. Myron, I want to go back to you. So some former EPA officials and even some Republicans have expressed concern over these cuts. How can you be so sure that the states are going to pick up the slack if EPA hands over authority for some of these programs? That's some of the things that Trump administration officials have said, that they're going to allow the states to lead on some of these issues. And then secondly, how can EPA impose these cuts when there's some dozens of statutes that require EPA to do some of these regulations and programs?
Amy, I think that the slack is in the agency. The EPA was created in 1970, and I think most of the audience doesn't know how serious our pollution problems were in 1970 and how we had really significant air pollution, water pollution, and polluted soils. The agency has largely accomplished its mission for clean air and clean water.
Mission accomplished.
And
what about Michigan?
And over, well, of course, look at the Gold King mine, which EPA created a disaster. So,
well, EPA exacerbated a problem that was there.
No. EPA has lied about exactly what happened. No, this is a very serious issue. EPA employees have lied to Congress about what happened with Gold King. This will come out of
but it was a mine that they were cleaning up. They didn't pollute it originally. They were cleaning
up. No, but they're complete incompetence at handling it. Anyway, let me get back to
what I see it around two.
Let me get back to where I think we can go on this. The EPA has, over the years, devolved a huge amount of the efforts under the statutes to the state environmental protection agencies. Now, this wasn't possible in 1970 because the states didn't have any environmental protection agencies. I think California did, but that was about it. So over time, the states have assumed more and more of the permitting and enforcement functions and monitoring as well. And I think this is an agency that has gotten fat and lazy, and that there is a lot of work to cut, particularly when you look at how this sort of freelancing that the agency has started to do beyond its statutory responsibilities. So, for example, there is no statutory responsibility to have a climate program, and yet And Congress didn't appropriate money for it, and yet President Obama was able to divert $160 million in the budget and a number of, I don't know how many hundreds of employees, to work on the climate program rather than the Clean Air Act statutory responsibilities. So I think that there is a lot of room to cut the budget, and you know, we find this in when corporations suffer from market discipline and they have to downsize, they often find out that they can produce just as much with, at just as high quality, much more cheaply with a smaller workforce. And so I think the EPA needs that kind of discipline, and I think this budget request is an attempt to do that.
Do you think the states have the resources?
The states are a mixed bag, and I think one of the things that Congress will do in looking at this budget request, because some of the budget requests are some of the capacity grants to the states, and President Trump said during the campaign that the part of EPA he liked was the pass-through grants to the states. So I think that there's some room for argument between the budget cutters in the White House and President Trump himself over what the states need to do their job.
Jeremy, you had a comment?
Yeah, I have a couple. well, look, there's a couple of lines of argument there, right? You know, one is mission accomplished. The other is, you know, the agency's doing its job badly and could do better. And then, you know, the states will pick up the slack, maybe, maybe not, which isn't so great if you read their downwind of another state, which, by the way, pretty much everybody does. So
maybe not Alaska.
Maybe California. Yeah, maybe.
California, Oregon, Washington.
So, mission accomplished. Look. The air is cleaner, the water is cleaner. That's a legacy that I inherited from generations before me. It's one I hope to pass on to you and your kids and future generations. But it wouldn't have happened, and it won't happen without the Enviornmental Protection Agency fighting for the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, the clean pesticides to keep unsafe toxics out of your home. It doesn't happen by accident. And half of people in this country are still breathing air that's unhealthy. There's a chemical called Durzban. It's a pesticide used widely on citrus, fruits, vegetables that we've all probably eaten. And there are serious concerns, safety concerns, that the Environmental Protection Agency has clearly spelled out that it is not a safe chemical. In fact, it's banned from your household use. But nevertheless, it finds its way into your house on fruits and vegetables. And this administration last week, because they've had such a thorough time to understand the science, that they're going to reverse an Obama regulation proposal to ban the use of that pesticide. That pesticide contributes to developmental delays in children, maybe associated with autism and other problems that I don't think missions accomplished on. So the environment's not solely responsible for the health problems we have. It's not solely responsible for lung disease. It's not solely responsible for asthma. It's not solely responsible for heart disease. It's not solely responsible for autism. But the environment matters. It matters to all of us. And I just don't buy the missions accomplished. What I do believe is that the Environmental Protection Agency, like every other government agency, can benefit from expertise from you and from the very dedicated employees there who work across Republican and Democratic administrations to do the best they can. That requires oversight, it requires resources. It is not faultless, and we should never assume that any agency is. I don't agree with your antidotes, but I do agree that there's always important to look at room for improvement. But consider this, the agency budget is already 20% lower than it was, and I think Amy, you referenced some of that. And this has nothing to do with efficiency, this has nothing to do with good governance. This is an ideological agenda to benefit a very narrow band of special interest, and an ideology that the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, needs to go.
Myron, what's the response to Jeremy's comment about the move last week to reverse the ban of this pesticide? Why do you think the administration is taking steps like that when that wasn't an issue on the campaign trail?
You know, there are always a lot of last-minute actions that administrations do, particularly, I remember the Clinton administration, Carol Browner at EPA, stuck the incoming Bush administration with decisions that had been put off for years to give them problems. And I think this is one of the examples of that.
Do you think they're going to reconsider it in another format and move forward with it, or will they just get rid of it altogether?
I don't know.
Do you have advice for them, Myron?
No, because I'm not a pesticide expert, but I would say this. The problem with the EPA is not that it has a bunch of dedicated employees, it's that they have more and more relied on dubious science and on junk science. And so they now justify very destructive regulations on the basis of science.
When you say that, do you mean the climate regulation?
Well, the biggest example is PM2.5. Fine particulate matter. So we have, for example, a mercury rule, a mercury and air toxins rule that was adopted during the Obama administration on the basis of a few million dollars of direct benefits, which were based on hypothetical modeling. They never actually found a single person who would benefit from the mercury rule. Many billions of dollars of costs. So we're taking money out of the economy for no reason. So how did they justify the rule? They claimed, oh, we have these things called collateral benefits, co-benefits, from reducing PM2.5. But if you look at the literature on PM2.5, there is very little in it to suggest that reducing PM2.5 levels below those already required by law have any health benefit. But they have two secret studies, two epidemiological studies, that they hold in secret so that other scientists cannot review and try to replicate the results or criticize the results, and they say, trust us. Well, those two studies they've been relying on to justify clean air regulations for decades, and for example, Gina McCarthy, when she was administrator, before she was administrator, she promised the House Science Committee she would share those studies, and then when she was confirmed by the Senate Environment and Public Works Committee, she again promised that she would do it. And then as soon as she was confirmed, she said, oh, sorry, I can't really do it. So I think that the scientific integrity of EPA in a lot of areas is pretty low, and it needs to be addressed. And I hope that Administrator Pruitt and the Trump administration will get very busy on that, because I think we are putting I'm willing to trust bureaucrats, but I think we need to verify. Trust but verify.
I do agree that I've looked at this the benefits question, and I have looked and seen that they do the benefits from things other than mercury is actually what accounts for most of the benefits of this regulation, which was finalized back in 2012. So you know, let's say argument's sake that we give. You know, okay, we give that to you. Can there be a way where you review the science without, you know, creating a bunch of mistrust in the country where people see the headline saying that the Trump administration is getting rid of a mercury regulation? That doesn't look very good. And combined with other things like this pesticide move, you know, there's, I think, a growing concern in the U.S. about how the Trump administration doesn't care about the environment. So how do you respond to that criticism?
Well, first of all, the Congress has been considering legislation to ban the use of secret science, and a bill from the House Science Committee has in fact passed the House several times, including just last week. Now, how most of the Democrats in both chambers justify the use of secret science, I don't know, but I have hopes that that bill will be passed. The chemicals and pesticides, we have fairly strong laws on this, and it seems to me that if we have regulators and political appointees that, at EPA that step outside the legal requirements, they will in fact be sued by the Environmental Defense Fund and other environmental groups to make them follow the law. So I have fewer doubts about these decisions. I think if the decisions are justified, they will will stand up, and if they are not justified, they will be thrown out by judges. So I don't have the same worries that we have an out of control agency here just kind of throwing stuff out. I don't think they're doing that.
Jeremy, do you have any response to this concern about the secret science? And are you trying to engage, or would you try to engage the administration about how to make sure that they don't go too far? Or maybe you want them to go too far. Maybe you want them to shoot themselves in the foot. So there could be a backlash. We've seen that before.
No, you know, like this debate, you know, being able to sit here and have, you know, important discussion of two very opposing views. There are things that need to endure beyond the fights of the moment. And good governance is one of them. And science is the core of it. And it's actually the strength of the Enviornmental Protection Agency. And I worked at EPA. I am not a scientist. But you have to understand that the people who work at the Environmental Protection Agency are nothing like the candidates you watch on TV, or even me and Myron, you know, sitting here having this debate, you know, trying to figure out their views of the world. You have people, like probably many of you, that want to find the most rational, smart way forward with all the data in front. And they value very much the integrity of the data, and making sure that that they are making cost-benefit decisions by transparently putting that out there. And the cost and the benefits have been the strength of the Clean Air Act, and the Clean Water Act, and the other EPA pieces that we've seen, saving millions of lives and improving the quality of even more. And the economic benefits are evidenced by the fact that we've seen such improvements in clean air and clean water over the last decades while growing our economy. We can do this. So science is something that has to transcend scientific process administrations. There will always be political appointees on both sides, you know, that come in with an agenda to do more or less in a certain area. But it's that science that's the bulwark. So back to what's really going on here. Just taking away the fancy name of secret science. All right. There's just a multi-pronged attack happening between ideological think tanks, Myron, you and others, the Trump administration, and allies in Congress, and also lobbyists for the worst of the worst on the polluter side. Not all industries that pollute and engage in this, but there definitely is work to try to weaken EPA and some other health agencies and safety agencies as well. And so we're seeing that in the form of the secret science bill and regulatory reform, which regulatory reform isn't about making regulations better, right? Regulatory reform is all about throwing up obstructions like, hey, guess what? You can't actually do any new regulations to update anything unless Congress affirmatively votes that a regulation is okay, which means nothing really get done. So it's all part of the agenda. Pruitt and others, Trump, has spelled it out. Bannon did it best. Stephen Bannon said he wants to deconstruct the administrative state. He basically wants to get rid of regulations. So all of these things are aimed at the same direction.
Amy, could I just?
Yeah.
I'd just like to summarize what Jeremy said. He said, I think he agreed that he's against secret science too. He's for scientific integrity.
That's right.
And nobody can defend the use of secret studies that cannot be.
The so-called secret study that you're talking about, Myron, is based on the fact that medical data used in studies is a confidential patient.
No, that's not true. There are epidemiological studies that use the data that take out the names and the addresses. California posts millions of these reasons for death on their websites.
Myron,
so you can find this as public information.
Myron, I want to ask you just again, are you worried about any sort of backlash occurring among voters and, you know, just people in this country in response to some of these environmental actions that the EPA is taking? Now, I'm putting climate change aside, some of these more traditional actions on the pesticides and any action you might take on the mercury regulation. Are you concerned about, you know, both, I mean, obviously the substantive environmental impacts, and further, the political and perception Trump administration not caring about the environment? Are you concerned about that at all?
I think we need to look at the election and what President Trump said during the election. And I think the basket of policies that he put forward on energy, environment, and climate resonated. They did not resonate in Washington, D.C., or among what I would call the bicoastal urban elite.
There might be some people in this room.
Well, people, I do not think it resonated with people who are in the economy of financial services, manipulating information, sitting in front of computer screens, working in office buildings. I think it resonated in the heartland states with people who make stuff for a living, grow stuff for a living, and dig up stuff for a living, because they have seen the results of overregulation. Jeremy said he's for good governance. I am too, and that's why I want to cut the EPA down.
But I'm asking you, do you think this, are you worried about a backlash though?
You should be. I don't like to predict the future. I think we need to see whether these policies do what President Trump said during the campaign, in which we at CEI have been arguing for years, which is there is a huge amount of backlog of investment in our productive economy, our energy intensive economy, that has been thwarted, not by environmental standards, but by the delays that have been built into the system for permitting, for wetlands permits, for clean air permits, for NEPA, environmental impact permits. So I think let's see what happens and whether we can actually get back to an economy where people have hope in their future rather than this idea that we have to get used to a 1% per annum economic growth.
So you said you don't like predicting the future. Those are my favorite types of questions. Following what is going to be.
Can I correct one thing? Very quickly. So there's nobody that voted. Trump didn't make the case to the American people when he was running for president that he was going to attack the Environmental Protection Agency.
Yes, he did.
And got it. It wasn't there anywhere. You look at the debates anywhere else. This was a hidden agenda. I'll tell you, there's a Quinnipiac poll out today where 2-1 people think that Trump's handling of the environment, they disapprove of it. It's more than any other issue, including immigration and health care. The backlash is already started.
Jeremy, I don't think you read his speeches. If you read his speeches, he said on numerous occasions that, quote, I want to abolish the EPA. And he laid out a long list of promises on energy, climate, and environment, which he is now fulfilled.
Well, as a reporter who considers himself unbiased, a little bit more than these two guys, I would agree that he did say it on a semi-regular basis, but it certainly wasn't a core value of his campaign.
He said it to his crowds, but he never did it on national television.
Why do you think he won Western Pennsylvania by such a big margin? Why did he win Michigan and Wisconsin? Because those
I think West Virginia maybe, but not the other two. Anyway, no. We don't need to rehash the election again. I'm sure you guys have all heard that. We need to be funnier if we're going to talk about that. Okay, so a quick lightning round question is what I like to call it, which means one word answers, which is very hard to do in Washington, so I urge you to stick to the rules. Going back to the budget very briefly, it was a 31% cut that the Trump administration has proposed. This isn't what you want to happen, it's what you predict will happen. How much of a cut to EPA do you think Congress will ultimately pass?
Less.
Can you give me a number?
Zero.
It's a number. So time.
12.
12%? Okay, and you think?
Zero.
You think it'll be the same?
You're trying to trick me.
I'm just confirming that you don't mean they're not going to pass.
I do. I think there's no.
No, you only get one.
You follow the rules very well.
I think we'll have a budget in the next month that keeps EPA at previous levels.
Okay, it's good enough for me. Somebody else for Canada, probably 15 words.
So he gets to skip
zero.
He gets to skip the next question.
Well, I want to focus, shift a little bit more to talk about climate change, which, you know, we've talked a bit here about more traditional environmental issues, which of course is EPA's core priority, but of course climate change has been a big priority for the agency under President Obama. And now, in light of the executive order that President Trump signed last week, the EPA is beginning the process to review That's the technical term, review. Many people are interpreting that as repeal. The Clean Power Plan, which is President Obama's signature regulation cutting carbon emissions from power plants. How many of you guys have heard of the Clean Power Plan? Good. Well, you know, I've spoken at a lot of events, and almost a lot of people haven't, actually. Keystone, everybody's hands go up. Anyway, so of course, as you may well know, it makes up the lion's share of the Obama administration's commitment to the Paris climate deal. So I want to ask you both, what do you think, first of all, what do you think, again, a prediction versus your opinion question, what do you think will the Trump administration do with the Clean Power Plan? There's lots of different avenues. They could get rid of it and do nothing, and then be sued by potentially a group like the Environmental Defense Fund. They could try to issue a very much more weaker regulation. Jeremy, I'll start with you. What do you think they will do?
And I think they'll issue a weaker regulation. I think they'll issue something. I mean, I don't know, right? So, but going with the hypothetical, our best guess is that they'll conform to the letter of the law, and try to find a way to end up with a standard that actually has no practical effect.
Myron, what do you think they'll do?
I'm of two minds. I think that's one possibility. I think the other possibility is that they will end up withdrawing both rules, the so-called Clean Power Plan for existing power plants and for new power plants. Now, in fact, of course, in their justification in Congress of these two rules, they never claimed that it would have any impact. They said that
the
Obama administration said these rules will not have any effect. And in fact, when Gina McCarthy was cornered about this, she was asked by the Senate committee, why are you doing this? She said, well, it's to show international leadership. Well, if you're not actually doing anything, I'm not quite sure how it shows international leadership.
So here's what they actually
said. She said that?
Here's what rule said, here's what she said when she released it, and here's what Gina said, all right? She said that it'll reduce emissions 19% with the rule compared to not having the rule within the power sector for CO2 emissions. That's an impact. She also said that the rule will not by itself solve climate change, but every fight has to start somewhere, every piece matters. That power plants are the biggest source of emissions in the U.S. and U.S. leadership is needed, and that delivered the Paris Agreement. Without it, we wouldn't have had it because it got China on board to commit to action for the first time in 20 years, despite your best efforts to keep China from acting, even while using China as an excuse.
Oh, I have so much influence over China. The fact is, here's what China promised to do in the Paris Climate Treaty. They promised to peak their emissions by 2030. Now, some people have said, some environmental groups have said, oh, but they're going to reach that goal.
You're cutting ahead of the conversation.
They're going to peak their emissions much earlier. But all of that they have committed to, all that they have promised to do, is to peak their emissions by 2030. Whereas we have promised to cut our emissions by 26 to 28% below 2005 levels by 2025. So, our commitment made by the Obama administration, I don't believe it's valid because it's a treaty and it hasn't been ratified by the Senate, but leaving that aside, the Obama administration made a real commitment. China made a sort of promise of good intentions. So, this idea that our leadership has brought China into the game is wishful thinking.
Going back to my question on, you know, what do you think the administration will do on the Clean Power Plan? You said that they could, in fact, decide not to do anything at all.
Yes.
Do you think there's the legal basis for that?
Yes, but I'm not a lawyer, so what do I know?
I mean, that's one of the reasons you don't know. When people ask me this question, I say, well, they could do anything. There's what they can do legally. And so that is the threshold question, whether or not they follow the law or they don't. If they follow the law, they need to regulate. The Supreme Court has been crystal clear on this on three different occasions, right? The EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, has a responsibility under the Clean Air Act to deal with greenhouse gases. So if you move forward from there, that triggers the responsibilities of reducing pollution from power plants. And then it becomes a question of the analysis of actually, can they build a case for weaker standards when so much of the nation is moving towards cleaner energy. It's going to be difficult for them to do, but you can bet they're going to try.
So, you know, kind of going, building on some of the comments you guys just made, you know, there's a lot of internal strife within the Trump administration about what to do on a lot of climate-related issues. Perhaps I would say there's more internal debate than I would have predicted before the election. Of course, lots of things have changed a lot since the election, so it's good not to be predicting business. But some of the issues that they're debating include, you know, what's known as the endangerment finding, which is a 2009 scientific finding that the Obama EPA issued, which basically said that greenhouse gas emissions endanger the public health and welfare of people and therefore need to be regulated. And that really is the legal underpinning of all of the Obama climate regulations. Now, there's been some on the more right-hand side of the conservative spectrum, you might in that category, who want to have the EPA get to review that endangerment finding. But then you have some other people who say that it couldn't legally withstand scrutiny and they should leave it alone. And on top of that, in addition to that particular debate, there's also ongoing debate on a broader level about what to do with the Paris climate deal, which is quite interesting to me and I'm sure to many of the people in this room. So let me just quickly talk about the endangerment finding first, I mean, because it's a little bit wonky, but it's very important to the broader climate debate. Myron, do you think they're going to review the endangerment finding?
Well, of course, I don't know, but I think the logic is overwhelming that they must.
Okay, but what do you predict? This is a mini lightning round question, which means yes or no.
Yes.
What about you? Do you think they'll review it? Yes or no?
It is so unfair to ask you to predict the Trump administration.
It's okay, we're among friends. People are probably not tweeting.
They declined to do it last week. I'll assume they stick with that.
So, what about the Paris climate deal? There seems to be a growing factions on either side. You have people like Ivanka and Jared Kushner who want to stay in it, and Rex Tillerson, and others who want to stay in it. And you have people like Steve Bannon and Myron Ebell and others who, and Scott Pruitt, I think, is in this camp as well, that don't like the Paris deal and want to pull out of it. Myron, again, what kind of machinations are you thinking are going on that you know are going on? Kind of insight into
this. Yes. There are several possibilities here, right? I think the first one is to stay in, but what does that mean? Because we have effectively withdrawn. The nationally determined commitment made under Paris, the actions taken by the Obama administration, and with just a very little bit of congressional action, achieved 55% of the target. So it is up to the next administration, that is this one, to figure out how to reach and the Congress how to get the other 45%. But if you withdraw the so-called Clean Power Plan and the methane rules, by far the largest single component of our nationally determined commitment is business as usual reductions in emissions. And the Trump administration has said that they are not going to take further actions, regulatory actions. The Congress shows no, there's almost no chance that they will take actions to reduce emissions. So, in fact, de facto, our membership in Paris is dead. We might continue to go to the meetings to get, I mean, if Rex Tillerson wants to go to these annual conferences the way Jeremy and I do, and I think probably you've been to them, you know, to get abuse from every outlet in the world.
How many climate talks have you attended, Myron?
No, I don't know. But less than 10.
What about you, Jeremy?
More than 5.
3, I think.
So you have a better carbon footprint than I do. I like those tens of thousands of people who go to these things. I, you know, burn up the jet fuel. But the other options are...
You report that to your funders? Is that one of your accomplishments?
Yes, we're proud of our carbon footprint, yes. I have one of those stickers. Okay, the second alternative is to announce that it was just an executive agreement and we're not going to pay any attention to it. The third is to say that President Obama's saying that we accept the agreement is invalid because it is in fact a treaty, and we will therefore take back his signature, and President Trump will then ask the Senate for its advice and consent. I think those are the three main options. I think there is a fourth, which is to withdraw from the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, because President Trump said over and over again in the campaign that he wanted to defund UN climate
It just makes me ill that you're actually talking, Myron, about going back to unraveling the Rio climate treaty that was done 25 years ago. Like, do you ever give up in terms of your ambition of just closing your eyes? What, you know, what if you're wrong? What if climate change actually matters?
Well, what if you're wrong, Jeremy? We've wasted trillions of dollars to no impact. What do you think all of these trillions of dollars, the impoverishment of poor people in poor countries, has achieved? What if you're wrong? You've created a regime of...
Am I going to have to put my chair between you guys? I didn't want to have the whiplash, but I would move my chair.
Well, let me just, I know we're running...
And I don't want to get into a tangential conversation about the science.
We've got to get it.
Well, I want to make sure...
We have about 5 minutes until we throw it out to you guys. So yeah, I'll let you talk about Paris for a minute.
Thanks, Paris. You got no monopoly on poverty and caring about people living in poverty. There is no evidence that the fossil fuel industry has lifted people out of poverty. People have coal jobs, people have oil jobs. We have a responsibility to anyone with jobs from any energy sector, but that includes building an energy economy for our future that actually already creates 2 million jobs in America, and that very much gets to Paris, because it is only in our interest as America to see global cooperation on climate change. It makes no sense with the leadership we did, this them going later than us. Yes, we're going first because we have done progress, we have led, and we've reduced emissions by over 10%. Why would we squander the leadership now that we have it and not invite China and other countries to now catch up and do the same thing? Of course they can't get ahead of us, but they may if we let Trump go unchecked and you get your way on what's going on. We need to keep driving emissions down, not see a turnaround, not this dream of building new coal plants, which is just a lie to the people in coal communities. It is nothing but a lie to say that getting rid of EPA is going to help coal communities live from poverty and bring those jobs back. And it's not fair, because if we don't look ahead at what we need to do on climate change and clean energy, it's just going to lead to even bigger cliffs in the future for everybody. So we need to stay on the course that we've been on and not turn backwards and go the other way.
Here's a quick lightning round question before we go.
They're all on his side at the start.
Yeah. You should have had those clickers where you...
You're going to sign the clock. Before we go to the audience questions, another lightning round, sort of yes or no, another prediction. It's your guys' favorite types of questions. So do you predict that the Trump administration will ultimately stay in the Paris deal or withdraw from the Paris deal? Not the UNFCCC.
You're on the transition team, you tell.
Withdraw.
And that's your prediction today, because I know it's sort of ebbed and flowed over the last few months. And
withdraw.
You think withdraw. What do you think, Jim? With all your sources inside the West Room.
You know, we environmentalists are always optimists, so go stay.
Great. Well, do we have any questions? We have the mics set up on either side. So we'll start with the gentleman over here.
Well, you better answer quickly.
Try to keep your questions pretty short.
And we'll try to answer briefly.
All right. Hi, my name is Reed, and I'm a senior at Georgetown. And my question is, the budget this year has a $73 million cut for Chesapeake Bay programs, and a lot of Republicans actually in Virginia and Maryland are decrying that budget cut. So I'm just curious kind of how you think programs like that that go to a specific region of the country, if that's the proper role of the EPA, if that should be housed by the states, and then the Republican argument, which I agree with, that more of these regulations should be coming from the people's representatives in Congress than unelected bureaucrats. If maybe both of you, from your own perspectives, can give us an outline of how to think about when an issue needs to come from bureaucrats and when regulation should be debated by Congress instead.
Well, I'm glad you trust Congress so much, more than the professionals at the Environmental Protection Agency. You can call them bureaucrats, you can call them what you want, but I get the point of your question. Look, in terms of where the boundaries is a good place to start. I mean, a lot of these are regional programs in the Great Lakes and the Chesapeake that are at stake. You know, right now, states rely on about 25% of their budgets for things like clean water cleanup and otherwise from the Environmental Protection Agency. You know, it's a fair debate on, you know, whether or not money should be spent on those programs, but I don't think it is fair to suggest, like Scott Pruitt does at EPA, that if EPA just goes away, the states will pick up the slack. Because they don't have the money and they don't have the expertise. There's also the issue of cross-border pollution, which we've talked about. It's a huge issue. It doesn't serve anyone's interest when states are competing in a race to the bottom to try to attract businesses based on laxer pollution standards. And that's an issue of downwind, and it's an issue of economic growth. But back here where you started with local congressmen, Republican and Democrat supporting this, I think that's one of the reasons we're not going to see Congress, there's going to be a lot of support for this kind of budget. We've already seen it in Congress, but not enough to get it done. And I think that's why, because you know, these programs have real benefits to the regulated businesses back home, as well as to clean water and clean air.
Myron, do you want to answer briefly this question?
I think that the Chesapeake Bay program needs serious oversight by the people's elected representatives in Congress who are accountable to the voters. I think that there are very serious problems with that program in terms of regulatory overreach. The TMDL, that's enough.
The gentleman on the side?
Sure. So I see Mr. Ebell's critiques of the EPA come from a methodological point of view, where there are issues with the way that science is carried about and with the methods behind a lot of the science, if not the science itself. What is the risk you see in couching this argument along those lines versus some of the anti-science perspectives that this debate seems to attract? What is the risk of veering too close to that side of the debate and maybe hurting your own cause?
Well, the science debate on a number of these issues is very involved, and I have been called a science denier, but in fact, it's the respect I have for science that I've been very critical of what I consider to be junk science at the EPA, and I would particularly say the science that went into, for example, the endangerment fund on greenhouse gas emissions. So I don't know that I have an answer to your question, but I think there are dangers from on all sides when we allow shoddy science to drive policy. And in fact, that is what has been happening, not just in the Obama administration. This goes way back. And so.
Do we have any scientists in the room?
I bet we do.
You want to raise hand?
Aspiring scientists?
I have a few hands halfway up.
Political scientists are scientists, aren't they?
It's kind of like a doctor as a PhD or something. Jeremy, do you have any quick thoughts on that science question? Over here again?
Thank you. So first, thank you both for being here today. My question is about what was briefly touched on in the conversation, secret science, especially the bill that the House of Representatives passed last week, the Honest Bill. Do you think it is too much of a burden to bear, for the EPA to bear, to only use such scientific inquiries or studies that are public, open, accessible for anyone to review, even given the exemptions they've made for certain like identifying information in medical studies, for example? Thank you.
Yeah, so I think transparency in science is important. I think EPA has a good track record with that. Just, we didn't get to the full conversation before, but again, a lot of the scientific studies are being done by universities and others. And EPA has been getting stuck in the position, and this is very intentional, of they're trying to pick on the agency on an issue where they know they can't actually, they are not the ones that actually can make the decision of whether or not to reveal the science. So look, if there was a rational process of sitting down, and figuring out make it easier for the EPA to do that. There'll be, in those limited situations, and they're very cherry-picked and limited with their boundaries, I think there'll be a lot of agreement. But again, that bill coming through the House on the heels of all the other attacks on the agency has been designed in a way to try to weaken and cripple the scientific process. Everything's about throwing up obstructions and barriers of actually moving forward.
When you have regulators who have huge powers that can destroy people's lives through regulatory actions, we can't just say, oh, we have to be nice to you and let's see if we can agree on something. We have to have real standards that they have to live up to. As I said, trust but verify. A lot of science doesn't matter to public policy, and it doesn't matter that scientists get away with phony results.
There are no phony results. There's no evidence of phony results. You were talking right about whether or not the information should be public. Were you suggesting that EPA has been making up data?
I wouldn't know.
But there's no evidence. Let's just be clear. There is no evidence. The EPA made up anything or that the data is flawed. This is just a convenient talking point to disguise the bigger agenda. It's a common tactic.
And a lot of it is that there's a disagreement over the science itself.
Yeah, but hold on. Jeremy, what you said is a big claim because the two epidemiological studies that justify the PM2.5 claims, we don't know particulate fine dust, very fine dust. We don't know if they've made up stuff because it's secret.
It kills people, right? It causes more damage in children. Are you saying that it all goes away, Myron, because you have a clever bill?
Jeremy, I think you're really out of date on the PM2.5 claims, and you've actually believed what some PR people at EPA have said. But let's go into the next question.
Let's go back into this side.
Okay, so mine is about some statistics I saw in a CNN article, which I thought were really interesting about a week ago, and they're from a Yale study, just in case anyone's wondering. But the first part is that approximately 70% or more of Americans, believe in global warming, and over 50% believe that global warming is really humans are causing it, but below 50% believe that there's scientific consensus on this, even though the stats I've seen say 97% of scientists agree on that. So I'm curious why there's a discord there and how we can fix it. And then specifically for Mr. Ebell, the same article talked about approximately 75% of Americans believing in strict CO2 limits from the government. So I would say that contradicts the claims that Trump made his policies clear and that Americans support those. So I'm just wondering how you feel about that number. Thank you.
Do you want to respond to it?
Well, I've learned to look at polls with some suspicion. It's very easy to agree to things that sound nice, but there is a lot of polling. For example, when the Waxman-Markey cap and trade bill came to the House floor, it was claimed that it would only cost the average American family $175 a year. Why is that? Because although most Americans
are talking about
this is important.
In 7 years,
history is important. $175 a year. How did they get that number? Because they'd done very intensive polling that showed that Americans wanted action on climate change, but they assumed the big industry would pay for it. When they were told that their electric rates would go up, they started to sort of move back. Well, I'm willing to spend a little bit, but I'm not willing to spend. Well, look, in Germany, which is far ahead of us in the global warming agenda in terms of implementing its policies, electric rates are now 3 times higher than they are in the United States, and hundreds of thousands, and I think in fact millions of people are suffering from energy poverty, having their lights cut off, having to choose between eating and heating in the winter. And this is a real issue. This isn't just, oh, I'd like to do nice things, particularly if somebody else pays for it. Yeah, I'm for all kinds of good things, but if I'm told there's a cost here, as well as a benefit, then everybody has to start judging the cost versus the benefits. And the global warming regime is already costing Americans a whole lot more than $175
per family. More pollution is not going to reduce people's energy bills. More pollution is not going to grow jobs. All right, just
what does that mean, Jeremy?
It means that your your policy, right? The whole underpinning of everything you're saying is that if we cut regulations, if we cut the Clean Power Plan, if we get rid of EPA, if we get rid of the PM2.5, which is soot, right? It's the stuff that actually made it visibly unhealthy, air, right?
You're quite wrong about that.
But well, PM10 and PM2.5, right? If you cut all of these things, right, the economy will flourish, right? You get these job-killing regulations, you know, out of the way. The reality is that the Clean Air Act by itself is preventing millions of lost work days, millions of lost school days due to people being sick. It is reducing our health care bills, and most importantly, it's saving lives and making people healthy. Clean energy, the future of clean energy, is not an economic thing to fear.
I just want to go really quick back to the other part of the gentleman's question. It's directed at you, Myron. You know, there have been a lot of polling that does show that there is, a majority of people do acknowledge that there is a climate change caused by human activity. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but you don't agree with that perspective, or you question it a lot more than most scientists do. Why do you think the public is having that sort of reaction in the polls?
There are a lot of questions here. One is, do we believe that greenhouse gas emissions, adding them to
why the public seems to agree with the scientists.
No, hold it. The scientists, this 97% number is totally fine, right? That's the first thing you need to understand. The second thing is that there is a consensus on global warming. There's a consensus that carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas, that greenhouse gases are being added to the atmosphere, and all the other things being equal. We'll see some warming.
What does that have to do with the question?
It has to do with the public does not agree with those proponents, those promoters of global warming alarmism, who say that we have to take immediate and very expensive action which will impoverish people.
Of course, that's not what the polling says, but maybe we should move on to the next question.
For no benefit. People think that we ought to be doing something because they believe they're well-intentioned.
Can I ask a question of folks?
Yeah.
Different piece, just on their engagement?
Why don't we do a couple more questions and then...
Yeah,
good. Hi, my name is Matt Morey. I'm a sophomore in the college. So, Mr. Ebell, I have a question for you. This is really loud. So, I just came from this event, actually, with a general of the United States military, and it was all about the security risk that climate change imposes. By the way, on your 97% thing, NASA says that that's the case, so if you wanted to disagree with NASA, go right ahead. But anyway, So my point was that if you want to deny the climate change, you're factually wrong and no one cares. But anyway, so getting beyond that, you proclaim to be a libertarian, and the central sort of idea of libertarianism is that the government can step in when the actions of some inhibit the liberties of others. So that means enforcement of contracts, that means prosecution of fraud. So why is it that you compromise your beliefs on this specific issue of some engaging in actions that create pollutants in the atmosphere that will impact the future liberties of some and liberties of people living now?
Well, it's because I don't believe that global warming is a crisis, and I believe that the policies being proposed...
On what grounds?
On scientific grounds.
Really?
Yes, and we can discuss that afterwards. I don't think we have time here. But I would say that the scientific debate has now devolved into one between the modelers and reality. The modelers are in charge of the debate. They have scary predictions, and there is very little empirical evidence to support the model's conclusions. And in fact,
hold it.
So I don't think global warming is a crisis that requires immediate, drastic, and incredibly expensive action. And moreover, the policies being proposed to deal with it are two or three orders of magnitude larger in terms of the costs than the benefits, maybe four or five times larger. So we're being asked to spend globally trillions of dollars a year for no benefit. It's all pain and no gain, and that's why I oppose it.
Do you think NASA is wrong?
No. Look, anybody can send out a press release.
Are you saying that some rogue person decided that climate science is written?
If you look at the studies.
Who's the rogue person position for the last 10 years?
If you look at the studies that claim that 97% of scientists agree, you will find out two things. One,
you're saying NASA doesn't believe climate change.
97% studies do not stand up to scrutiny. They are laughable.
That's not what you were just saying. You were saying there was one person at NASA who wrote.
No, I said anybody can send out a press.
I know you work for him. There you go.
Hang on. Let's go to the next question. We're running out of time.
Let's go over here.
Hi, my name is Anisha, and I am a sophomore in the SFS, or School Foreign Service. So this is a question for Mr. Ebell, but it's based on Mr. Symons' quote that he said earlier about how clean energy is not an economic fear. How do you evaluate the cost predictions that you cite, and how do you control for the fact that the cost of innovating within the constraints of environmental regulations has been historically overstated? So like Keystone example, DuPont, and the cost of like innovating away from CFCs.
Yes, that's a very good question. I believe in innovation, and I believe that the people who are best suited to innovate are clever people with capabilities working in free markets, not being commanded or commandeered by government bureaucrats. There is an incredibly long history of government ordering things that turn out either not to be possible or not to be a very good idea. So we can go through a long list of things that Republican and Democratic administrations, Republican and Democratic Congresses have mandated that turn out to be not such good ideas. And I would give as an example the corn ethanol mandate. If anybody thinks that government knows best, you ought to look at the history of the corn ethanol mandate, which was not a Democratic thing, it was a bipartisan thing. Passed by a Democratic Congress and signed by a Republican president, and Big Corn has been cleaning up ever since. So I'm for innovation, and I agree that there are huge advances to be made in energy technology. I just don't think the government can wave its wand and say that thou shalt happen.
Jeremy, do you have any?
No, this picture.
Yeah, we're gonna get.
Hi.
One more question.
So I'm Zoe, I'm a senior in the college, and my question to you is for those of us who are concerned about climate change and don't have much faith in the current administration's policies combating that, I'm actually curious about both of your points of views about what we should do as individuals if we can't rely on the government for it.
Thank you. Thanks for asking.
Jeremy, do you want to start?
I'd love to. let me start by asking a question that I did want to ask, which is, is there anyone here? I know there have been delegations from Georgetown for the White House Keystone protests, some of the marches that have happened on climate change. But I'm just curious, are there people here already feel they've stood up and taken action of some form? Wow. So thank you. It matters, right? It matters a lot. It's not an immediate payoff, but the thing I fear more than anything for the work I've been doing for a long time, what Myron doing is, whether you agree with Myron or with me, people not being engaged, right, on these very important issues is the biggest problem. Now, I know I haven't addressed, that's probably my biggest fear. So it actually, it really inspires me. It's one reason I definitely like hop on and agree to, you know, come do this with you, because knowing that you all are out there working on this, that, you know, sometimes it gets pretty, pretty tough seeing some of the stuff that's rolling down. So, what you can do though, in terms of action, if you can do one, I mean, you're in a unique position here. I mean, there's the things that you can do to get involved, right? There's things, you know, we have to pay attention to who's being elected. We need better candidates going into office. We need people that are in EPA and other agencies who are figuring out these complex questions. We need people to just take action and talk to their friends, because there's a lot of things competing for people's time right now. They're all very important. But make no mistake, despite our best guesses of what Trump may do, the stakes are huge and the danger is real, because there are a lot of allies in Congress and elsewhere. So get engaged, but if it's just one thing for you at this point of your lives, I would say, whether you agree with me or him, if there's something you're passionate about, make it a part of your life, make it a part of your career. You know, make a difference, figure out a way to do that. When I, well, last thing I'll say, but you know, a long time ago, when I was in college and undergrad, a group of traveling scientists, perhaps the rogue scientist at NASA who figured, put NASA on record, but a group of traveling scientists came by and talked about climate change, and I was blown away, and it was exactly an after hours thing like this. I have no idea how I managed to find myself there, but I was blown away that the scientists, you know, were just laying it out like it was, and, you know, that made a big difference for me. And it's just to be able to work on something you're passionate about, if you can figure out a path that's not easy, is something worth doing. And it can be anything, it can be poverty, it can be anything.
Myron, what's your response to the question?
My response is that the university years, particularly those as an undergraduate in an elite university, you have a chance to actually not waste your time on the tawdry business of politics and political engagement,